we live in a split continent. On the one hand, Europe means economic crisis, Ukrainian crisis, refugee crisis. And then again, rising extreme right from Poland to France, authoritarian tendencies in Hungary, double-digit unemployment in the south. But on the other hand, 3 million Europeans mobilize to say no to TTIP, a trade agreement giving yet more leeway to corporations. In Spain, citizen-led coalitions take power in cities across the country. Across Europe, thousands mobilize to say refugees welcome. The Europe that's in crisis is the Europe of the status quo. The Europe where decisions are taken in secret and the strongest countries prevail. The Europe where center-left and center-right join hands to cling to power and continue with business as usual. This time, it's true, there is no alternative. There is no alternative to radically changing course. But then, what are the strategies and the social forces that are going to make change come about in Europe today? We discussed this today in Vienna with Katerina Anastasiou from Change for All, Alexandra Strickner from ATTAC Austria, Kurto Wendt from Refugee Convoy, and Walter Baier from Transform Network, who is hosting us today in their offices.
The crashing of the Athens Spring made one thing very clear, that at the level of the nation state, it is impossible to change your own country, let alone the Eurozone as a whole. The obvious conclusion is that either you advocate for a dissolution of the Eurozone, or you start thinking about a democratic movement for change of the European Union. With these words, Yanis Varoufakis presented the plans for a new manifesto for the democratization of the European Union only a few days ago on Open Democracy. And this is really the discussion that I want to begin from today. One thing that it is important to keep in mind is that when we reason about the democratization of the European Union, or democracy in fact, in the European Union or beyond, it is not only institutions that we're looking at, it is not only the institutions of democracy, but it is the practices of democracy. It is as much about democratic practices as it is about democratic institutions. And democratic practices on a transnational level also mean the capacity of the people of Europe, of citizens, of social movements to mobilize and organize and advocate for change at a level that goes beyond that of the nation state. Perhaps Alexandra, starting from you, TTIP with 3 million signatures collected across the continent is one of the most successful examples of citizens organizing at a transnational level. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about that experience and how such a movement has been possible, but also a bit about the difficulties that you have encountered in having to deal with an institutional setup, that of the European Union, which is not very permeable for change and for demands of change coming from the bottom up.
I think the fact that TTIP is a policy that is happening at the European level and that is going to affect us all, regardless of whether we are in Austria, in Germany, in an Eastern European country, in Spain, I think that helps to build that. And we, as a transnational movement that was started particularly in more of the Western European countries, because there we have a history of struggling against free trade agreements in the past decade, we have taken a deliberate strategy to also see how can we help and build up this resistance in Eastern European countries. So we really went out there, we started to find other actors and made a collective effort. And in that sense, I think it's a quite interesting experience of what we managed to build so far. Having said that, the other thing is that although we have this massive resistance that is growing on a daily basis, at the same time, what we can see is that we have so far managed little to change in terms of the political reality of TTIP. It's still, the negotiations are still going on. Both governments and the Commission are sticking to the project. So we are not yet there, and it's a collective process for us to discuss how we will manage to really make it possible that TTIP And not only TTIP, but the free trade agenda stopped. So it's we are encountering this difficulty that although you have so many people in the street, you have so many signatures collected, you have so many actors, many trade unions in many countries, and many social movements, environmental movement, etc., all on board, yet they are not backing down on that project. So
you said something interesting that I think also leads us on when you said that TTIP is an issue that affects us all at European level. And if I may, so the situation that we have encountered regarding Greece over the summer also affects us all. And why has it been so difficult to make the equivalence between the struggle of the Greeks and the struggle for change of all the other Europeans? And for example, we hadn't seen during the OHRI referendum in the summer a great popular mobilization such as we have seen in 2001 in the squares in Spain. What's been the difficulty there in your experience?
I mean, there are multiple facets one has to look at. I don't think also that there is a definite answer to that. But in my view, and the way I've experienced the struggle, there are some very, very evident reasons for that. For example, the Greek Solidarity Campaign didn't come with the electoral victory of Syriza. We tried to organize in a very broad, in a very broad group of movements, including social movements, NGO attacks. There were a lot of people in the international trans-European scene that wanted to mobilize in Greece. We were not strong enough. You have to take into consideration that since the crisis started, and since Greece actually entered the first memorandum, there was a consequent construction of a negative profile of the Greeks as such. Almost in every aspect of the trans-European press, you would see stereotypes of the lazy Greeks, the corrupt Greeks, the nothing-doing Greeks. What happened then was January, and this, electoral victory of Syriza made a lot of people opened, of course, the discourse in the popular media. So all of a sudden you had Syriza and...
It acted like a
Trojan horse you can always seize. And I think this is also more or less what the first Greek government tried to do, use as much press as it could get to transnationalize the Greek problem, talking about the debt again, talking about a government's... maybe unfortunate argument of national sovereignty, being able to change politics that are obviously and rationally not working, and so on. So after Syriza emerged in the as a political subject, also in the public dialogue, somehow we didn't manage to foresee the swift that happened in the solidarity grassroots movement, because instead of a solidarity towards the Greek people, it became a solidarity towards the government. And when the referendum was announced, since the networks were already set, it was easier, to manage to have transnational mobilizations. We actually lived days where we had demonstrations coming in from all over the world, from Colombia to Georgia, Morocco, Australia, New York, Chicago, and all of the European cities. There were people mobilizing for the OHRI. It wasn't a mass movement, but it was evident that there were people there, not Greeks, not in Greeks in nationality, but realizing that someone should support a country that within this humanitarian crisis actually chose left and not right.
Sure.
So it was
there. And the image we have in mind now is that of Tsipras being cornered by Schäuble and by other heads of states at 5 in the morning in the dark, famously grey rooms of the European Council building.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow this popular mobilization, the catalyst that Syriza might have represented, hits a brick wall in the minds of many when it comes to the way that decisions are actually taken. But I want to go back to that after looking at very briefly introducing also the question of the refugee and migrant movement. And something that we have seen also at the level of transnational mobilization is certainly mobilization of European citizens welcoming and advocating for a change in policy regarding migrants and refugees coming into the European Union. But we've also seen a great political protagonism of the refugees and migrants themselves, who, crushing border after border, have often managed to achieve what many of our own movements have failed to achieve over the previous years, which is a refugee crisis, which is not the crisis of the refugees, but it is the crisis of the border regime of the European Union. So to what extent do you read the present situation and the protagonism of the migrants as a political act, in fact, that forces change?
Yeah, we always argue that they are the people who organized the European Spring in some kind, because they are not that weak. They are weak on the road because the governments make them weak. They make them stop there. They treat them in a cruel way. But when you have the possibility to talk to them for 2 hours in a safe car or so, they seemed like a new generation of creating a new Europe. So I think they are our hope. So the hope of some kind of basic movements in Europe. And I think the difference to the TTIP is that on this topic you have the coalition of open borders. You cannot argue just they are fleeing from war. Of course we have to, because the middle of the society wouldn't support, but we do it because we want to crash these European borders, and they help us in this argumentation. And TTIP is also supported by the right wings who want to close borders. So we
maybe you can tell us very briefly what you've done with the refugee convoy.
Yeah, on this point we saw that Austria opened the border with Germany, yes, together, and one day on the 31st of August the trains from Budapest to Vienna ran, but the second day was stopped. So we put us in this situation that we run instead of the train. It's everybody knows this situation, that if the train doesn't run, we do it, and we use this historical window and drive with I think 170, 180 private cars to Budapest and brought about 400 refugees secure to Vienna. Not just the way. It's the discussion in the car. It's discussion about asylum possibilities in Sweden, Netherlands, Germany, Austria, so they can decide what to do. And we changed cards and we changed telephone numbers and so. So it's some kind of really basic
socialization process.
Yeah.
Maybe Walter, I can use you to try and in fact, give an answer to that quote. There is no such thing as a single issue struggle because we don't live single issue lives. So to what extent do you think it's possible to imagine a change in the different domains that we have been discussing at the level of the European Union today without a radical change of the European Union itself, and notably of the way that it functions when it comes to democracy and the permeability of popular power to effect and implement political change at also an institutional level?
Yes, there is no single issue alive, and it's also not a single issue crisis. This is the most striking element of the current situation, that the crisis of the European Union affects all levels of life, the working relations, the welfare states, the border regimes, human rights, legitimacy of the governments. So the issue actually is to confront this multiple crisis with a complex alternative which must be democratic, feminist, ecological, human rights orientated, and social at the same time. And I would say again, it is a question of being able to propose this kind of alternative and at the same time to acquire the necessary power to push it through. What for me, the Greek experience, for example, says is that three hypotheses failed. The one has been the hypothesis of Varoufakis, who tried to convince his colleagues with expertise. The second has been the hypothesis of Tsipras, who wanted to convince the social democratic heads of the governments to support him. And the third hypothesis had been the ones which we as Transform have made, namely that we were able to create in a very short period of time such a huge social movement and such a huge mobilization which would change the power relations in Europe. And without doing this, no change is possible. In a nutshell, I would say, we must construct the movements. I think we can be optimistic at this movement which you describe, and the TTIP movement which you describe, and the change in Portugal, and now Corbyn in the UK. I have the feeling that on different points it pops up, but it does not pop up at the same time. And unfortunately, it doesn't pop up in Germany, which would be, of course, a good thing. But times will change, and I'm pretty optimistic that we will experience this change we are fighting for.
And what do you think? I mean, we've got some clear scenarios on the table. There is a scenario of the status quo, a status quo that, depending on your view of it, may or may not be sustainable even in the medium term. Then there is a clear scenario of a return to the national level. In some cases, that takes the form of pretty nasty nationalism, such as in Hungary or in fact in Poland, as we have seen only a few days ago coming to power. In other situations, that takes the form of a left approach to the return of the national primacy of the nation space as the space where political change is still, so some people argue, possible, and there are a lot of friends in the UK, for example, that make that case. And then there is perhaps a third scenario, a plan D, if you like, a plan for democracy in Europe, which goes in the direction that you, Walter, were saying a moment ago. And to what extent do you think this is feasible?
It is. I mean, you cannot believe that it is not. If you believe that something is not feasible, you don't get on with it, except if you're a masochist. Yeah, it's... But in order to do so, I think in order to make this change, in order to help this movement emerge, in order to build it up, in order to make it continuous, in order to make it strong, we have to be brave. We have to be brave to confront our mistakes and our weaknesses. And like Walter, I have another obsession. I keep playing out the scenario in my head. What would have happened if the elections that took place in Greece in January would have happened a couple of months later? I mean, because of the defeat in July, nobody is actually an exaggeration, but there was not enough light shed to the experiences happening now, like Portugal, Spain coming up, Ireland coming up, and so on and so on, and the referendum in the UK at the end of the day. So what would have happened if we would be able to orchestrate this in a domino? And it is, I mean, the reasons we were not able to do that are obvious for me. The coordination is not working as it should. I mean, these contradictions are out there, and we have to claim them and say, okay, this is the Europe we want.
Which kind of we is...
Yeah, what is the we? The we is this maximum consensus. My we is the maximum consensus. Where I can agree with somebody on a change. This is my we.
To me, I think the one thing when we talk about division, I think, of course, we and me, I mean, me and the people and the movement I'm engaged with, I think we all have as a vision a democratic Europe. And we want different institutions, even though we might not have a fully fledged plan of how these institutions look like. But What I think we're not looking at, in my view, sufficiently, and if we want to get there, we need to start to talk about economic power and how we deconstruct economic power.
Mm-hmm.
Because what we clearly say in our debates with TTIP is, yeah, we can struggle to fight TTIP and CETA, and we can manage perhaps to stop these agreements. But it will be only a question of time when the next one comes. Because you have this corporations and this ever more concentrated economic power that is there, and that of course has an interest and that likes the way things are, and that is doing anything to make the things more they like it. And so in that sense, for me, this debate we're not having, we're looking very much, when we talk about the construction and the struggle for democracy, mm-hmm. we're very much looking at institutions, we're very much looking at how do we coordinate and how can we exert influence on institutions where it's very difficult to have an influence at the European level, but even at the national level it's becoming more difficult. And I think we need to start discussing these things and not fool ourselves that we will be able to change that without changing this relationship.
I mean, there are nice slogans. I will interrupt you, but there is this free movement for people and not for goods or finance capital, for example. This is something that can work for combining struggles like this, no? Free movements of people, free movements for humans. And these slogans are up there. And I just had this flash now of you introducing our talk today by referring to the 2011 struggles. And I'm going through this phase where I'm trying to reconciliate and see what we lost and what we won. And we lost something since 2011. What happened in 2011 is that the people occupied physically the squares and lived through direct democracy. They actually did it. I mean, in the squares in Sintagma, in Madrid, in Spain, in all over Spain, people were organizing in huge assemblies, and we lost this. We also lost it by this hope. This hope actually tricked us into believing that changing a small part of an institution will change the whole society. But on the other hand, within this defeat now, the defeat of Syriza, we also won some things. Also in the TTIP struggle, a huge thing that is in making people that are not very politicized engage is the fact that TTIP is being negotiated behind closed doors. And that was also the case with the Troika.
I think this was such like a Woodstock of democracy, yes?
Mm-hmm.
You get the positive emotions, you get for a small area and for a short time the
euphoria.
Yeah, and then they think that it's possible to change. Mm-hmm. It's necessary to feel this. Moments, but on the other hand, as you said, we didn't take any power over in this thing. But when you, for example, if you see the actions of Ada Colau of Barcelona, she's traveling all over Europe and looking for best practice examples how to manage a city in a social way, in a non-racistic way and such kind of thing. I think we have to prepare ourselves that the things are getting worse.
Yes.
Worse and worse. If you see the self-confidence of the right wings, I'm optimistic that on the end of this way, we will succeed. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
But we have to prepare ourselves that we are not getting mental damaged, we are not getting non-solidarity with our friends. You see that the precarity is not easy to stick together with friends who are... So we have to look on these issues to prepare ourselves for the fights. And I'm not scared to fight for a better
mm-hmm.
society. And I was yesterday, the day before yesterday, in Spielfeld at the border of Slovenia and Austria, and it's we are not in a situation that we can do anything there. There were right wings marching. There were some pub owner who says he has a pepper spray, and every refugee he comes in this pub, he gets the pepper spray and not the beer. And even us who support the refugees are forbidden to park our cars there for 5 minutes. So we are not in the situation to win, even if. But I think that there would be an illusion that a bigger change of society can be organized by it's getting day by day a little bit better.
So I wanted to say that yes, I agree that the situation is quite scary. And I love that you were referring to a plan D. I must confess, I absolutely do not like this talk about the plan B. I do not like it because it's based on the illusion that there is a plan E. This is the ever increasingly authoritarian following of the neoliberal agenda. And then there are we who submit the plan B, and everybody is called to follow this. It's not the case. The plan B is on the table, and the plan B is the plan of the nationalist right to re-establish the relations in Europe.
D for democracy, not D.
That's why he liked you.
That's what I liked about it. That we must get rid of this idea that on the European scene there were two forces, the neoliberals and us.
Mm-hmm.
And the neoliberals, they do what they always do. Now they do it with more austerity, with more authoritarianism. Look at the five presidents report. By the way, five presidents. It is not the case. We must position ourselves in a twofold confrontation. The second thing which I wanted to say, I don't see any left content in nationalism. I believe that this is a very severe issue. Nationalism always has been an ideology of the right, and it still is. And if some on the left side believe that they can use an instrument of the right in order to promote progress, they are terribly and tragically wrong.
Let me ask you a direct question on this, also in your role as Transform. There is an attack on democracy which is happening at all levels. The country where I'm from, Italy, is about to approve a new electoral law that shuts out representation from parliament. At the European level, the attack on democracy has been going on for a few years already, and the crisis, if anything, has been used to exacerbate even more that attack. Part of the anti-bodies that resist such an attack are the intermediary bodies, amongst which one counts trade unions and political parties. Why is it so difficult in Europe to have a unity of the left? Why are we still in a situation where when the European left organizes a meeting or a summit or a demonstration, it uses an acronym that no one in their right mind understands, which is GUE-NGL. Why can we not have a single united European left that presents an alternative to the nationalists and to the neoliberals? Why is it so difficult still today?
I would say that the deepest problem in all this is that there is a huge illusion amongst the social democrats, the trade unionists, and even the left liberals, as they think things will continue as they continued. They still believe you have the European Trade Union Confederation, you can negotiate, you will come to a settlement, and then things will more or less go smoothly. They will not, because what we now experience is, sorry for the bad language, this is class war. This is the effort to degrade the life conditions of the working people, and including the females, and including the migrant workers, and including the precarious workers, in the broadest sense, all people who must do something in their lives in order to survive.
Sure, I think we can agree
yeah,
that.
But I think his question was
what
about
the
organizing the radical left. Yeah?
I did not want to address the question so directly because I did not want to be impolite, because it exists actually. The GUE NGL represents all parties left of the Social Democrats, let alone the Communist Party of Greece.
No. But is it possible to say that we have a plan to 2020, we find a collective name, and our individual national names will be the subtitles of the...
I would love this.
You are in a position to manage this discussion?
But to manage this would be... I think that there are two dimensions which are crucial to the political left in Europe. One is the relation with the social movements in its diversity, and the other thing is that the left, the radical left, must exercise its function, and the function is creating alliances, broad alliances, and this for the moment, and that's why I referred to the Social Democrats, the trade unionists, and even the left liberals. But the bigger problem than the political weakness of the left is the unawareness of the so-called democratic and progressive forces to understand the danger of the moment, socially, politically, culturally, ecologically, in all ways.
I think there is another problem, too. I have to add something. An additional problem is some kind of calcification, you know, some kind of some spaces, some traditional organizing spaces have been calcified. They look like statues. For example, the trade unions. The trade unions, mostly from the Greek experience, I mean, 2012, where the collective agreements were demolished in Greece, I had serious problems making Austrian trade unionists, for example, believe that this is going to happen. This is the one part. Because they're totally bureaucratized, I don't want to say corruption, but maybe I do, but apart from that, Kurto said something very important. We experience not only the precarization of labor, we experience the precarization of life. And the precarization of life also implies a political precarization. You have voters that vote the lesser bad right now. Not people that have a vision of something they want to do, but what's going to be the least worst thing that can happen to me?
That perhaps puts an even greater responsibility on those of us who may have a sense that the moment we're living through and the historical phase we're going through is a crucial one. And perhaps part of that responsibility also lies in getting our act together and representing a coherent, significant, organized alternative,
mm-hmm.
so much to the neoliberals and the social democracy and to the nationalist right of Plan A and of Plan B. And I really like what Kurto said about the Horizon 2020, if we can mimic EU talk, EU jargon, which is not a horizon of a united left party. I think we need to go very much beyond that. But if I can close with a desire for what I would like to see in 2020, is to see at European level the virtuous competition between political parties and social movements that we're seeing, for example, in Spain today, in the relation between Podemos and the different citizens' movements that are taking up cities from Madrid to Zaragoza. I need to leave it here, but thank you so much for the discussions, and until next time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
They came with water. They came with food. Some rifled through their wardrobes to find something to give. Others remembered the children and what they might need. Young and old descended on Vienna's busiest train station with a convoy to help thousands of refugees arriving from Hungary.